Thank you, sir. Thank you, Vivek ji. Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. It's an honor to actually get this opportunity to present in front of my own people, because I also hail from Bihar. So whatever I have been doing across the country is, I mean, I can probably use this opportunity to bring this technology to Bihar as well. जी सर, कुछ कह रहे हैं आप? माय माइक्रोफोन इज माय माय वॉइस इज लेसर अ व्हाट? एम आई ऑडिबल सर? Sir, I think DFO Begusarai is speaking something. Okay. Yeah. So, I take this as a great opportunity, and primarily whenever I've been interacting with all the people across the country, especially from the bureaucrats' perspective, primarily the challenge is understanding of the water body itself in its natural state. As you said, Dr. Ghosh, that water bodies can be emitters also, they can be sequesters also, they can be blue carbon sinks as well. The biggest challenge is transforming the emitters into the sequesters. Usually, whenever we are doing a water treatment, we are just focusing on water instead of focusing on the complete aqua ecology itself. So that is where the key difference is between our technology and the technologies which are there in the market, because most of the technologies which are there in the market are actually working on water only, not as a holistic approach for treating the entire aqua ecology. So that is where the difference lies. So let me just give you a couple of slides so that you are able to visualize what I am talking about. I'll first start from what exactly is a natural condition of a water body, how it gets polluted, and what exactly is our approach for resurrecting the ecology. So we are not treating water, but we are doing the resurrection of the native ecology of the wetland. So let me just share the screen. So is it visible, sir? Okay. So this slide, I'll just explain the usual approach that we have. We do a sewage treatment, or we do rainwater harvesting, or we do water body desilting, or we do the plantation, right? This is the usual approach that we have been adopting for last about 30-40 years for water conservation. Now, typically what happens is the sewage treatment plants are primarily involving physical, chemical, and at times biological treatments also. Rainwater harvesting that we do is purely focused on building apparatus, which is the physical installation. Water body desilting is, there are multiple processes for water body restoration that we involve. There are certain processes like the complete water is, decantation is done, deweeding is done, and then desilting is done by physical methods. The new approaches which have come up in the market is like bioremediation and phytoremediation, wherein again there is an intervention into the aqua ecology by introducing an organism, or by introducing some plant weeds which will absorb phosphates and nitrates from the water, and then we have a plantation drive around the water bodies. Now, the key challenge in all these aspects is the ecological aspect of it. Whenever we are doing the rainwater harvesting apparatus installation, the rooftop rain is brought into a pit, and then it leaks into the soil, wherein it does add to the soil moisture, but it is not doing the aquifer recharge. Again, when you talk of the plantation drive, what we plant is saplings, not the trees. And saplings themselves need a lot of water to grow into trees. So this water, wherever rainwater harvesting is done in conjugation with plantation drive, the plantation drive succeeds, because rainwater harvesting is adding soil moisture and plantation need that soil moisture to grow into trees. But it is not contributing towards water conservation, because trees are ultimately also water consumers, they are not the water producers. Now, sewage treatment plant, we all know the technology. I mean, everybody here is already well aware of the sewage treatment plant technology. Coming on to the water body restoration approach, when we are doing the desilting work, the problem is we don't understand the difference between the sludge and the silt. Now, sludge is a human creation. Whatever pollution we are adding to the water body, when it gets settled, instead of being suspended or dissolved, when it finally gets settled in the bottom, that is called a sludge. Whereas silt is a natural formation, because the water molecule is bipolar. The top is negatively charged, whereas the bottom is positively charged. So whenever a bipolar molecule is moving forward, it will always move in a spiral way. And when it is moving in a spiral way, the soil below the water will get grinded. And this grinding work will transform the soil into silt. Now, silt is nothing but nanoparticles of soil. These are created naturally for opening up the soil capillaries. Now, the surface water body soil capillary link is established to the aquifer. Whatever be the depth of the aquifer doesn't matter, but this soil capillary links the aquifer to the surface water body, and this link makes the water travel vertically depending upon where the pressure is high. Like in monsoon, the pressure on the surface water body is high, so the water will travel vertically from surface water body to the aquifer, so the aquifer recharge will happen. Whereas in peak of summers, when the evaporation rate is very high, the motion is exactly opposite, because the pressure in the aquifer is high and the surface water body has got a lesser pressure because the evaporation rate is high. So the water is pulled up from the aquifer to the surface. Now this ensures that the water body doesn't get flooded, neither it gets dried. So this soil capillary link between the aquifer and the surface water body is very, very important. So when we are doing the desilting work, we are removing the silt also. So because the silt is removed, so there is a new soil surface, and this soil surface will have to be weathered for aquatic ecology. So that is why when we are doing the desilting work, the aquifer recharge stops naturally for the natural water body. So these are the key inputs in terms of understanding the water body and where our approach is going wrong. So let's understand the basic difference of ideologies, because whatever we have been doing is what we have been doing till now as per the guidelines of the Western science, wherein water is simply H2O, soil is dirt, air is mix of gases, and we are the people who are supposed to understand nature and use the nature as a consumer. This is the approach of Western science. Whereas if you look at Vedic science says Chitijal, Pavak, Gagan, Samira are the five key elements to life. Without the five key elements of life, life would not have been possible on the planet. So going by this virtue, no life cell is possible to be created out of the dead substances. We have done a lot of technological advancement in the world today, but we have not created a single living cell without the source being a living cell. So, if these five elements are the key resources of life, they themselves cannot be dead. Now, the moment we say that soil, water, and air are living ecologies, the entire perception or the approach toward the treatment will change, because all life forms have been blessed by the nature of one particular property, that is self-healing. That is why we have recently seen during the global lockdown that the water bodies, the rivers, have started becoming cleaner, the air became cleaner because of the global lockdown. So that means there is a self-healing mechanism that exists, and if we are able to understand that self-healing mechanism and we design our development strategy around it, it will be much easier and much faster result that we can get, and the ecology can be restored, through which we can get clean water, we can get natural food production, we can get rid of the air pollution or water pollution or soil pollution. So this is what is our approach, the Vedic science-based approach, wherein we say that soil, water, and air are living ecologies. Now, why wetlands are important is wetland is the only, you can say, natural apparatus where all the three come in direct contact. Bottom is soil, then we have water, and then we have air. So if we do the resurrection of the native ecology of the wetland, all the three get affected and all the three problems get solved. So now, proceeding further, let us first try to understand what is a natural water body. Every natural water body has been created by nature, and certain responsibilities are showered upon the natural water body. And once it is there in its natural state, all these functions will be restored. So a natural water body is, as I said, the combination is bottom is soil, then we have water, then we have air. Now there is a consistent exchange happening, irrespective of whether we are talking about a flowing water body or a static water body, whether we are talking about a lake, pond, a river, rivulet, or just a mountainous stream. Any water body will have the same combination, and every water body is having the same responsibilities. So as I said, soil capillaries are the link to the aquifer. So one responsibility is aquifer recharge. So water travels from top to bottom and from bottom to top. Whenever the water is traveling between the capillaries, it is also contributing towards the mineral fixation and mineral cycle. So when the water is going from the top to bottom, it is also carrying the overload of nutrients along with it to the bottom, and between the soil surfaces, the minerals are fixed, and when the water is being pulled up from the aquifer, it is also bringing some mineral electrolytes along. Now these electrolytes are basically required in the aqua ecology, in the aquatic food chain. So there is a food chain going on within the water. So aquifer recharge is one responsibility. Maintaining the soil moisture is another responsibility, and maintaining the mineral cycle in the aqua ecology is another responsibility. Now let us understand the food chain within the water. So there are single-celled organisms which are consumed by the planktons, which are again consumed by the bigger organism like fishes, shrimps, crabs, turtles, and excreta of these bigger organisms is ammonia, which is again neutralized by the single-celled organisms. So this is the aquatic food chain. Now, because of this aquatic food chain, the life in the aqua ecology is very well maintained. Now, another responsibility which the single-celled organism have is performing photosynthesis. There is the biggest pool of single-celled organism which gets created naturally in a wetland, because all the three possible habitats for the single-celled organisms. You asked a question, sir? Sir, somebody is asking a question. Okay. So what I was talking about is the single-celled organisms are plenty of them are also autotrophic, because you get the biggest pool of single-celled organism in a wetland, wherein you have the microbes of soil also, microbes of water also, and microbes of air also. That is why this is the biggest pool for the microbes to exist in any wetland. And plenty of them are autotrophic, which perform photosynthesis or which perform methane synthesis. So one natural action being performed by them is the process of carbon sequestration. So they absorb the greenhouse gases. Every water body in its natural state is absorbing greenhouse gases from the atmosphere, performing photosynthesis and releasing oxygen as a byproduct. So this oxygen is contributing towards the dissolved oxygen level. So any water body in its natural condition will have a high DO level. So when the DO level is high, obviously this is the supply, and biological oxygen demand or chemical oxygen demand are the demands. So BOD and COD remains low because the DO is high. So this is again a natural process for which you don't need to intervene chemically, biologically or physically. No energy is wasted in this production. Was there a pause? I just got a message that the audio was not correct. Okay. So there is a natural process of photosynthesis because of which the DO level of the water is high. Now this is one exchange with the atmosphere that the carbon sequestration is happening. There is another exchange that happens parallelly. That is, as I said, the water molecule is bipolar. The top is negatively charged, whereas the bottom is positively charged. And by this virtue, the top surface of the water body is negatively charged. Now, what we call as air pollution is basically the concentration of particulate matter in air, the PM levels. And all the particulate matter in air is all positively charged. So when we talk of air pollution mitigation, any natural water body in the natural condition is naturally doing air pollution mitigation, because all the particulate matter will get attracted to the top surface, which is negatively charged. And once it is settled down on the surface of water, it gets consumed in the aqua ecology. So this is the exchange which is happening with atmosphere. One is carbon sequestration and second is air pollution mitigation. So this is the responsibility of the water bodies. To sum it up, we can say underground aquifer recharge, maintaining the soil moisture, maintaining the mineral circle, the water pollution mitigation by consumption of whatever waste is coming in the aqua ecology, air pollution mitigation and the carbon sequestration. So these are the responsibilities of the landlocked surface water bodies given to the water bodies by nature. Now let's get on to the next topic, which is how does the water body gets polluted. Water body does get polluted naturally also, and there is a natural cure as well. So let us understand how does the water body get polluted naturally. So whenever there is any natural phenomena which is beyond the understanding of the terrestrial animals or aquatic animals, like there is a tsunami, there is a typhoon, there is let's say a cloud burst, there is a volcanic eruption, there is movement of tectonic plates, there is thunderstorm. Any these kind of phenomena, when it occurs, there is a ripple effect on the water body. So like there is a, let's say, a volcanic eruption. Volcanic eruption will give ripples to the water body as well, but it will also emit a lot of particulate matter in the atmosphere. All this particulate matter will eventually settle onto the water body, and it will add metals and minerals to the water body, which will be an overload because it is not expected by the water body. So it just suddenly happens. So that is adding a pollution to the water body. Then when the aquatic organisms understand that, okay, there is a thunderstorm, or there is a lightning, or there is any kind of a natural activity happening, they excrete too much. Their excreta is all ammonia. So when you have too much of ammonia, that will lead to eutrophication. Then when there is a storm, what happens is the plantation on the embankment area will shed their leaves or fruits, and all that will fall into the water body, which will add a lot of phosphate to the water body. Again, too much of phosphate will lead to eutrophication. So this is the contamination of the water body naturally. Now, whenever this happens, nature creates weeds. So there are huge varieties of weeds, from azolla to hydrilla to water hyacinth to water lettuce and all that. Now, all these weeds are there to consume excess of phosphates, nitrates, sulfates, and once they consume all of them, then their feed is finished. When the feed is finished, they will get starved to death, they'll dry down, and they'll sink in the water body, and they'll also be consumed in the aqua ecology. Now, that is contamination and decontamination of water body naturally. So this is all predefined natural phenomena. Now, what happens when we human beings enter into the aqua ecology? What we do is we add sewage, or we add industrial effluent into the water. Our sewage is nothing but excess of nitrate, phosphate, nitrite, or ammonia. And our industrial effluent is nothing but excess of heavy metals and minerals, plus phosphate, sulfate, and nitrate. Now, when this gets added to the water body, there is a natural reaction. When the excess has gone up, nature will create weeds, which will come and they'll start consuming. So this is not a new phenomenon for the water body. Now, the only thing that goes against the nature is our addition is not just once, but it is consistent. So weeds will come, but they will never go, because whatever they have consumed, that is being supplied regularly. And this regular supply is creating a new kind of a situation in the water body, wherein weeds are coming and they are flourishing. So they'll eventually start acquiring the entire surface of the water body. And when the surface gets completely acquired, the sunlight will get reflected. When the sunlight is getting reflected, obviously the process of photosynthesis will suffer. So within the water body, whatever photosynthesis was happening, that will get compromised. Again, I got a message that there is a break in audio. Am I audible, sir? Sir, am I audible, sir? Okay. So what happens is that the weeds have started acquiring the top surface, and especially the kitchen waste that we have also has fat, oil, and grease, which is lighter than water, and it will float on the top surface. Now, this surface floating is actually laminating the top surface and dividing the water to get access to the sunlight. So, when the photon supply is compromised, the process of photosynthesis will suffer, and then this starts the complete chain reaction. When the photosynthesis is not happening, the DO production is suffering, whereas our addition of sewage is consistent, or industrial effluent is consistent. So this phosphate and sulfate, which is coming in on a regular basis, that is adding to multiple things in the water. Number one, the viscosity is going higher, so the water flow is getting compromised. Then the color is becoming darker, so again it is becoming more difficult for the sunlight to penetrate in black water or gray water. So and then parallelly the BOD and COD is going up. The TSS and the TDS, the suspended and the dissolved solids, their count is also going up. Ultimately, when the demand is high and the supply is low, it will create an anaerobic environment within the water body. Now here again nature comes to the rescue. The decomposition of the organic matter, which was supposed to happen aerobically earlier, in lack of oxygen, that will now happen anaerobically. And anaerobic digestion has got a byproduct of hydrogen sulfide, because of which there is a foul smell around the water body. Now, the weeds have covered the top surface, the viscosity is compromised, the water is almost standstill. Now, this creates another problem, because the still water is the best breeding ground for the mosquitoes. So, the mosquitoes have come, weeds have come, foul smell has come. Now, then happens the biggest challenge, which is settlement of the suspended and the dissolved solids as a bottom layer of sludge. So when the bottom layer of sludge has deposited, it will choke the soil capillary, and the link to the underground aquifer also gets compromised. So the water harvesting is completely choked because the bottom is filled with sludge. Now this all happens step by step, but this is a chain reaction that happens. That is how the water bodies are getting compromised. Now water body is getting dry not from the top but from the bottom, because the soil capillaries are choked and the replenishment of the aquifer is not happening. So eventually it will make the water body shallow, and then we have wonderful land mafias in the country who will just fill up the water body, acquire the land, and then eventually you will see that the water bodies have vanished, right? As per an estimate which was published in Times of India, there are more than 5.5 lakh water bodies which have disappeared from the surface of the planet post our independence. From 1947 till now, there are more than 5.5 lakh water bodies which have disappeared. So they have actually been filled up and the plots have been cut, and the end resultant that we get is a disaster like the recent floods that we saw in Chennai, the flood that we saw in Kerala. That is because the natural law is disrespected by setting up of the colonies. So this is the decay process. Now, coming on to the Vedic way of restoration, as I said, all wetlands, all water bodies are living ecologies. So basically, if you take a simple plain example for everybody to understand, what we are having in the water bodies today is a nutrient overload, because we are adding too much of sewage and too much of industrial effluent to the water body. These all metals and minerals are nutrients. So these nutrients are overloaded in the water body, which is beyond the natural consumption capacity of the water body. So when the natural consumption capacity is less and the load is higher, you can compare it with a simple example that somebody has eaten a bit too much. Obviously, he'll fall sick. There'll be indigestion. So when somebody has overeaten, the person doesn't go under surgery. It is simply taking some digestive medicine. So all we are supposed to do with the water bodies is give them something for digestion, so that the consumption capacity is increased, the metabolic rate of the aqua ecology is hired up, so that the excess overload is consumed. So what we do in our method is basically we have to study the water body, we have to study the agroclimatic zone, we have to study the soil, water and air, and then as per the Vedic science, there is a pool of herbs from which we have to carefully select certain herbs and then make a solution. So what we make is a concentrate which is 100% herbal botanical extracts, and this concentrate is diluted into the fresh borewell water. This diluted concentrate is released into the water body. Now what happens once it is released in the water body is what I am going to explain the next. Here in this slide you can see this is the Kyonomics diluted concentrate. It is poured into the water body, and once it is poured into the water body, what happens to the water body is on a chemical, physical and biological level is what I am explaining now. First, on a physical level, when this is poured into the water body gets supplied with millions and millions of free electrons. Now these electrons, when they reach a phosphate molecule which is waiting to be decomposed within the water, because whatever you put in water, the decomposition process starts, that is waiting for the decomposition to happen. The moment the electron exchange happens, a single atom of phosphorus is separated from two or three atoms of oxygen, and this oxygen, because it is being released within the water, is adding to the dissolved oxygen level. So when the DO level is going up due to disintegration of a phosphate or a sulfate molecule, so this oxygen which is produced in water will bring up the DO level, but then eventually, because we have lots and lots of and abundance of phosphates and sulfate, so eventually the oxygen bubbles will start to appear on the top surface. So when it is appearing on the top surface and we have a thin layer of fat, oil and grease on the top surface, it will start increasing, hurting the tensile strength of the fog layer, and once the tensile strength is breached, the bubbles will start to burst. When they burst, they create a puncture in the top surface, and from that puncture the sunlight will enter. The moment sunlight has entered, the process of photosynthesis will restart. When the process of photosynthesis has restarted, naturally the DO level will be maintained. So this is on the physical level. Now let's come on to the physico-bio level. Every electron has got a charge of 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Now this charge is good enough to give a CPR shock to the dormant native microbial life. When they come back to life, what they need is oxygen to breathe. So the DO level is already high, so they've got enough oxygen to breathe, and they need something to eat. So the single atom separated from a phosphate or a sulfate for a sulfur or a phosphorus is what they can consume, and when they eat something, they are single celled organisms, so the propagation is cell division multiplexing, so they will increase in numbers and they'll start to consume and decompose all the organic matter within the water body. So the environment has become aerobic. By default, the anaerobic life will cease to exist, because the very reason for them to exist was absence of oxygen, lack of oxygen. So when the oxygen level is gone up, the anaerobic life will cease to exist. So anaerobic digestion will not happen. The digestion of the organic waste will now happen aerobically. So the byproduct of hydrogen sulfide will not be produced. And when it is not produced, the foul smell is gone. So the foul smell is gone, and the decomposition of phosphate and sulfates and the organic matter, everything has started happening now in the natural aerobic way. So when it is happening in the natural aerobic way, obviously the viscosity of the water is getting reduced, the suspended and the dissolved solids are getting reduced, because the microbes are consuming them in the natural way. So the feed for the weed is also getting reduced. So when the TDS and the TSS is getting consumed, naturally the viscosity is getting lowered. When the viscosity is getting lowered, water will have normal waves. When they have the normal waves, the mosquitoes breeding will cease to exist because they breed only in still water. So when you have a wavy water, the mosquito problem is also gone and your foul smell problem is also gone. And eventually, when the complete suspended in the dissolved solid, the phosphates, sulfates, nitrates are all getting consumed due to the microbial action, the weeds will also start getting dried and they'll sink into the water and they will also be decomposed like any other biological waste, any other organic waste. So the visual appeal has come, the weeds have gone, the algal bloom is gone, mosquito breeding has stopped, so there are no more mosquitoes. You have a wavy water, you have a natural ambience, there's no foul smell. And then the toughest task, which is consumption of the bottom sludge, starts to happen. When the complete sludge is consumed, naturally the soil capillaries are back and all the functions of a natural water body are restored. So the aquifer recharge is happening, the mineral cycle is maintained, the flooding is eradicated, the drought conditions are eradicated, the air pollution mitigation is happening, and the carbon sequestration is happening. So this is what a natural body is, and that is how this is restored. So when we talk about rejuvenation of the lakes, like for our understanding, we have created a nomenclature of a standing and a flowing water body. So lake will come under the static water body or the standing water body. Lake rejuvenation means air pollution mitigation is happening, carbon sequestration is happening, sewage is problem is solved because whatever sewage is coming into the lake is getting consumed when the ecology is alive, and the aquifer recharge is also happening naturally. Coming on to the river rejuvenation, when the rivers are rejuvenated, the drought and the flood mitigation naturally happen because the soil moisture is maintained, and whatever excess of water will come in form of runoff water, storm water, or wastewater, that will get consumed in the aqua ecology, and the aquifer recharge will naturally happen, right? So then you have the addition of the waterways. The same water can be used for irrigation, aquifer recharge is happening, drinking water supply is there, and air pollution mitigation is happening. So that is the economics of river rejuvenation through the ecological way or the of what we call as Vedic science. Now here are certain success stories wherein we have rejuvenated the water bodies using this technology. This was the lake in Chhattisgarh. As you can see, it is all surrounded by dense colonies, and the entire colony sewage was coming in, and this was restored in situ condition when none of the drains was stopped, and still the water body was rejuvenated. All the algal bloom had gone, mosquito population had gone. The chemical toxin which had come due to the visurgent, that was also consumed in the aqua ecology. This is EduTT Lake, Ahmedabad. You can see this was the pre-treatment condition wherein you can see the fungal growth. There was a algal bloom. The water was dark green in color. And this is the difference of 15 days. This was 15th of December. This is 30th of December. You see the water is completely still here, and here you can see how wavy is the water, right? The sludge deposition had the consumption had started. It was not completely consumed. You cannot do it in a matter of days when you have collected in a matter of years, right? So this was the condition of the water body in last 25, 30 years. We cannot eradicate the problem in a matter of 30 days, But then there you can see the substantial difference was there. And this is Jhilwala Park, Delhi. You can see the pre-treatment condition, algal bloom, fat oil and grease, still water, all the features that I explained were there into this water body in pre-treatment condition. This is 4th of June and this is 15th of June. The flock of birds was back, the aquatic life was revived, the water was wavy, the viscosity was reduced, no foul smell, no algal bloom, and I mean the life in all forms was exuberating. And you can see again the difference is just, this is 19th of June, this is 4th of June, just a matter of 15 days. But in 15 days you cannot just completely restore. The complete restoration as per our definition is when the complete sludge layer is consumed and the aquifer link is re-established. When the aquifer link is re-established, the soil capillaries are re-established, that is the time when you can say that the water body is now back to its original condition wherein the water body was created. Then it will take its own sweet time to get contaminated back to the level of pre-treatment conditions. So what we recommend is for doing that, either the government shares the bathymetry report so that we are able to understand what is the amount of sludge in the bottom. Yeah, what I was saying is, for the right approach, either we request the authorities to share a bathymetry report so that we understand what is the amount of sludge in the bottom, or else, if we don't have that data with us, we always recommend that the restoration work must go on for at least a year. Now, coming on to the next case study, this is Mohwa Lake in Raipur. Here, the problem was different. About 70% of the surface was covered with water lilies. So, this is because water lily is a very weak weed that gets eradicated very fast. Had it had been water lettuce or let's say water hyacinth, it takes about almost more than a quarter for getting completely consumed. Can you see the screen, sir? Just a sec. That's what they. Just a sec. Let me just reconnect. Is it visible now? So this was about the weeds in the lake, and till now whatever I've explained are all static water bodies or lakes or ponds. Now I'll come on to the next, which is a river. This is Mandakini River in Chitrakoot, District Satna, Madhya Pradesh. And this river we restored in the month of January 2020, 12th of January 2020, we started the project. This was a pilot which we completed after a month. The 12th of February 2020, it was completed, and there was a sea change difference because you can see the water samples also here, all that was consumed. So I think we have discussed all the case studies. These are all the authorities which have been using this solution so far, and that's about it. This is what our technology is. You can have the queries if anybody has any queries, any questions, you can ask. Yes, sir. No, sir, this is 100% herbal extract. Yeah. No, it's not related to cow dung or cow urine. Cownomics is just the terminology that we use because we are using Vedic science for linking cow to economics. That is why we have termed it as cownomics. Otherwise, there is no cow dung or cow urine. This is 100% herbal extract. Yeah. Yeah. No, sir, for the first 1 year, it has to be done continuously till the time. After 1 year, it is not required. Yeah. Only in condition wherein you are able to isolate the water body from the incoming drains and what do you call industrial effluent and all that, because that is the source of pollution load. So if you are able to isolate, then obviously you don't need further treatment. But in case if you are unable to isolate, if the contamination is coming on a regular basis, then ideally what we propose is you should continue with the treatment. But in case if that is not continued, then also it will take its own sweet time to get back to the level wherein we started the treatment. Because once the resurrection of the ecology is done, it is having its own immunity against the contamination. So it will be able to sustain for some time, but for how long it will be able to sustain, that we cannot comment. Yes. 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 Right. I'll just explain, sir. Actually, I was giving a presentation to one of the state pollution control boards. There also they asked me the same question. When we are putting in our concentrate, I told you it is all we are supplying the water body with millions and millions of electrons. Now, electrons are just giving a CPR shock to the native microbial life, and they're coming back to life, right? Now, the typical problem of where I was giving a presentation was very high fecal coliform in the river. There was not a problem of DO, or there was not a problem of BOD, CO2, or TSS, TDS, but they were specific about very high count of fecal coliform. So they asked me that if you are going to make the entire environment aerobic, the DO level is going up beyond 5 also, then your treatment, whatever you're adding to the water body, is getting flown away. So if it is getting flown away, how will it affect a particular patch? So when we were having this discussion, I just told them that, sir, the fecal coliform is getting increased only because sewage is coming in, right? They said, yes. Then I said, sir, if the environment is not supporting the fecal coliform multiplication, how is the count getting high? Because sewage addition is also getting flowed out. the sewage which is coming in, it is also getting flown away with the river current. The volume of water is high not just for my treatment, it is high even for the sewage addition. So technically, the sewage addition should not create the count to go up, because whatever is getting added is getting flown away to a different location. So in that case, till the time you are not treating the environment, you are giving the right environment for the coliform to grow. Because whatever is the original addition, that is not just the count. The count includes whatever multiplication has happened due to the entire river environment getting polluted. So what we are working on is treating the environment of the water. The aqua ecology is getting resurrected, and to understand the resurrection process, when I'm talking about the electrical charge or the electrons, basically it is like you can compare it with a drain which has got let's say petrol or kerosene flowing in it. When you light a matchbox and you throw it into that drain, the entire flow of kerosene will get burnt. So this entire burning is along with the flow. So when we are doing the resurrection, it is resurrecting along with the flow. Yes, one thing will happen, that okay, if you want me to treat only a patch of 2 kilometer, I cannot do that. Probably the effect will be there in 5 kilometer or 10 kilometers. But it is not that this 2 kilometers is not getting treated. This 2 kilometer will definitely get effect in terms of all the parameters. But yes, the effect will get elongated to certain higher distances only because the flow is on. Sir, compared to the technology that we are talking about, it depends. Like if you are talking about a sewage treatment plant, I will be just about a fraction of the cost. Sir, engineering methods are damn expensive compared to us, because our method would be hardly about some fraction of the cost that engineering methods cost. Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah. No, we have not patented, because Vedic science is available to everybody. Anybody and everybody can do a research on Vedic science and develop. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Very much, sir, very much. Yeah, yeah. Definitely, sir. Yeah, 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 yeah. No, all that facility of manufacturing is there with us, sir. We are having a very scalable methodology, so that's not a problem at all. I mean, even to the extent that even if you want districts and districts to be undergoing the treatment, we've got adequate facilities for production. That's not a problem. In the chat, let me just scroll down in the chat box. Okay, the first one is about कार्यक्रम केवा सुरू होणार आहे. अच्छा, दिस वॉज बिफोर द सेशन स्टार्टेड. ओके, हेमा. Yeah, I'm able to see. Hema Jha ji has asked a question. Sir, as you mentioned, due to electrical charge, phosphate sulfate disintegrate, the increases the amount of oxygen and aerobic process prevails. What happens to the phosphorus and the sulfur further? It is consumed by the microbes. There are sulfur-eating microbes, there are phosphorus-eating microbes as well. Could you please just explain a little bit about how sludge is being taken care of by the herbal solution, or we do some remedies for that. Okay, the herbal solution is not doing anything to the sludge. Herbal solution is just doing the resurrection. Due to the electrical charge in the electrons, the microbes are brought back to life. And the conditions of production of DO level going up, and the feed being available to the microbes, due to these favorable conditions, these microbes only decompose the bottom sludge as well. Like they are decomposing the suspended and the dissolved solids, they are also decomposing the bottom sludge layer. So after the bottom sludge layer is decomposed, obviously the sludge layer is removed and the soil capillary links are re-established. So I hope you got your answer, Hemaji. If you have any further questions, you can please come up in the chat box. Thank you, sir. That was helpful. So nice to get all information from you. You're most welcome, Hemaji. It is a pleasure. Atharva Doke ji is saying no, nice. Okay, if you have any question, this is not nice meeting. Atharvji, you can ask your queries if you have any. I think that's the only query that we have. Yeah. And any other questions, Vivek ji? Q&A. Anusha Pandey. Anusha ji is asking, is there certain capacity in these wetlands until which we can introduce the concentration for speeding up of decomposition process? Is there certain capacity in these wetlands until which we can introduce this concentration for speeding up the decomposition? Vivek ji, I think this question is not very clear. If Anusha ji could explain the question in a bit more detail, I would be able to answer. Can Karnomics? No, any size of water body, any size of water body can be treated. I mean, even to the extent that if you're talking about a Koleru lake, which is 122,000 acres, that can also be treated. No, if you're talking about smaller water bodies, yes, we have done the testing on the smaller water bodies. That is why we have set a limit that bare minimum the size of the surface should be minimum 10,000 square feet. Less than that, we don't treat. Because we are doing resurrection of the native ecology, that is why ecology must exist. We cannot treat a swimming pool. So if there is a concrete bottom, if there is a tiled bottom, if there is a epoxy flooring in the bottom, our solution will not work. So there has to be a connect of the soil, then the water, and then the air. It should neither be laminated from bottom nor be covered from the top. That's the limitation. Yeah. Sure, sir. Definitely, sir. So you are a stalwart. What new can I tell you? I mean, you just being too humble. Thank you, sir. Sure, sir. Yeah. 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 Right. Right. Yeah. And sir, the best part for the plains like Bihar and even you talk about the eastern Uttar Pradesh and all, because these are all farmlands. Farming is one of the key resources, and the best part is, I mean, we have showcased this, and we have done a case study also in Chhattisgarh, wherein after this treatment, the water became a neuro-immuno-booster for plants and animals. So this water can actually create a microclimate in the farm, wherein the farm becomes disease pest and weather resilient. So there is no need for any fertilizer, insecticide or pesticide, no hormones required, and your yield is also higher up. So that is the biggest advantage to the plains and the agrarian economies of the rural part of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Sir, I would love to, as I said, I mean, it's a pleasure to present to the state of Bihar. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Right. 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 Perfect. Perfect. Right. 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 Right, sir. राइट सर, राइट सर, राइट सर, राइट सर, राइट सर, नो सर, डेफिनेटली I'll be honored to have this opportunity to work for my own state. So, in case if there is any opportunity to work on a pilot anywhere in Bihar, I'll be more than happy to get that opportunity. Right, sir. Right, sir. Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Right, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir.